play.
What went wrong here? Well, first of all, the pig fly for too long, too high, and too far. And also, the pig had created a very effective airtight seal with which it's holding back a huge amount of water. So the first thing I want to do as a physicist is use Newton's second law. So force is mass times acceleration. Your acceleration is your change of velocity over time, so something that looks like this. And finally, instead of looking at the force on the pig, I much prefer to look at the pressure the water has on the pig. So if we divide our force by the cross-sectional area of the pig, we can find the pressure. Now I did a lot of online research, and the best candidate here for the pig would be a stumpling pig. They're quite small, they fit in the barbecue. A good one would be 12 kg when you cook it at half the weight. So I said the math is about 6 kg. For the cross-section area of the pig, I've been a bit more liberal and I've approximated it to be roughly a cylinder. Now, the cross-section area would be that back side of the pig, which distinctly lacks a curly tail. On these online forums full of Americans, they enjoy bragging about the size of their stuffing pigs, and they use the midriff girth to brag. Midriff girth to you and me means circumference. So if I have the circumference, I can find the radius, which allows me to find the cross-section area. Now, sorry, there's a camera. I want to find the change in speed from this point to this point. And then I also want to find the time between these two points. The Simpsons is recorded in 30 frames per second, which means every still frame, you're seeing 30 still images. So that means from this point to this point, I can calculate as a 30th of a second. And then for the distance, I've had to be a little bit more liberal in the approximation to get. The only thing I can measure here is Homer. So I got a reference Homer, and I lined him up to the cartoon Homer in the scene. And that gives me an archaic measurement system of 6.7 homers to 3.1 homers. I'm assuming the pig is ejected at a right angle to the dam, which kind of makes sense. Think of a fluid coming out of a hole, it would be at a right angle. And so using Pythagoras, that's 5.94 homers, which you can convert to meters, because we know Homer's height is exactly 6 foot tall. So that allows us to find the speed of the pig, the change in speed from one point to another. And now that we have all the values in our pressure formula, we can find the pressure, which comes out to a rather disappointing 92,000 pascals, a little less than atmospheric pressure, about 13 sneezes, or one pressure cooker bottle, which I've been told not to talk about too much. Pressure is also related to the height you are submerged within a fluid. So pressure is the density of the fluid times the acceleration due to gravity times the height you're submerged. Rearranging that for h, and then subbing in for the values for the density of water and the acceleration due to gravity, we get that the height the pig must have been submerged before it was ejected was 9.4 meters. Which isn't that surprising, but if you take a look at this frame here, which is the last frame we've seen before the pig is ejected, 4.3 seconds later. That means the water has to have been rising at 9.4 or 4.3 meters per second, or 2.19 meters per second, which is approximately the height of Shaquille O'Neal. So if that situation were occurring in this room right now, I think front row judges, you'd be dead in about 10 seconds. And so I've classified this scene here as physically improbable. Now there are some fixes. It could be possible that the river doesn't actually have water in it, but something much denser. And this is alluded to by the animators right here. Okay? And if you look at an earlier episode in The Simpsons, scene from one, episode three, Bart catches a fish in the river and it has three eyes. So we can see here that there's probably nuclear waste, nuclear runoff in the river, which is making the water much heavier, much denser, with heavy elements like uranium. Another explanation could be that there's a cannon in the dam, which sounds unbelievable, you're all flickering now, but remember, there are they won't puncture themselves and kill us and maim us. So we're going to think of a tire in depth here. Now, this is for plastic offer a cylindrical membrane. You can think of a tire as being a rubber membrane filled with air, and it's approximately a cylinder, okay, a short, stout cylinder, a Michael B. Higgins cylinder. Like humans, tires actually feel things like internal stress and internal pressure, probably when initial amount is run out. And so the internal stress here is a function of the rubber in the tire, okay? How much stress can it handle? And eventually, if you pump enough air in, you'll reach a critical pressure at which the stress, the maximum stress, is exceeded and the tire will puncture. So rearranging that, we can get an expression for the critical pressure that these tires can have. And again, as I talked about before, instead of looking at just the pressure, we want to look at the area over which this pressure is distributed, and then we can take a look at the forces involved. So what area is that pressure acting over? It'll be four times the area each tire is making contact with the ground. Now, I'm apologizing, because I have to put this picture in here, I have to draw this myself, but it's a rudimentary sort of way to look at how much of a tire is touching the ground. It's not actually that flat, I'm just exaggerating the flatness. But using junior clear trigonometry, you could find that that length there will be 2r sine theta, where theta is the angle you have to turn to until your tire stops being flat. Obviously, all tires on a car have a natural sort of flatness to them. And so, plugging in that will get this. And now we want the force of Homer to be greater than that pressure times the area. So plugging in those values and simplifying, that's actually the radius of the tire cancels, interestingly. And the only force Homer has to work with, really, is he's a large gentleman. Okay, he has quite a lot of mass. And so the force he's working with here is his weight, m times g, mass times gravity. And so if we divide by g, we'll get how heavy Homer has to be, or more, for him to puncture these tires. If you look at this still frame here, the animators haven't actually put in any flatness to the tire, which I've forgiven because I realized how hard it is to draw a tire. So I've been fair, and I said, say it is about 10 degrees. That maximum stress is actually quite a poor value for tires. It's a really bad tire without that kind of stress involved. So I'm assuming here that Homer is incompetent, or an idiot, or both. And the thickness of the tire is about 2.5 million. When you plug that in, Homer has to be heavier than 292,000 pounds. Which, if you're wondering if Homer actually might be that heavy, earlier in the episode, we see him weight on a weighing scale, which is about 292,000 kilograms. So, what are the fixes we can look at here? Homer could have been driving on recklessly dangerous tires. Homer could have made up that extra weight, that extra 291,870 kilos, by eating uranium, calories per gram, which is not a recommendation for any of you like going to the gym. Don't eat uranium. The final explanation is, if you remember what Homer was wearing there, it's possible he made up the extra weight of what he was wearing. Now, I'm not a fashionista, but what he's wearing is known as a muumuu. Usually considered light and frocky, but he could have been making up that extra weight if his muumuu was made of dark matter. And so, with that, I'd like to move on to the final scene here. So, your action that's going on here is with going to be Coke and popping candy. And what we're going to do is, in this balloon, there is popping candy. I'm going to mix it into the Coke, and if we don't all die, something's wrong here. Now, the reason it's wrong is because it's a chemical reaction. Well, this reaction here is actually a physical reaction. There's carbon dioxide trapped in the popping candy, which when it dissolves in water, will release the carbon dioxide. So there's nothing chemical going on here, nothing nuclear going on here. It's just good old physics. And while you're watching that balloon expand with carbon dioxide, I'd like to thank my training, creator of